Kind thanks go to Surfshark VPN for sponsoring today's episode. SpaceX Starship updates, waiting for the hop and Crew Dragon splashdown summary.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Looks like it's handled.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. I mean, this is insane. In the last 7 days, we had Perseverance launch, we had Crew Dragon Endeavor return home with Bob and Doug, and now we're hopping with a Starship. It's intense and incredible, and a special time for everyone on Team Space. First of all, let's start this one off with a good old Starship update segment, as there's a lot to talk about as always. Mauricio from RGV Aerial Photography did another flyby of the Boca Chica SpaceX facility, and he just rocks. If you haven't done so yet, please do consider becoming his patron. His work is absolutely fascinating, and he does deserve it. Thank you. What you're seeing here is the ever-growing Starship construction site. We get a clear view of the growing Superheavy high bay, and as you can see, there are many, many cars parked on the road again. This is direct testimony to SpaceX's efforts right now. Everything is focused on driving the project further down the planned milestone list. The whole site is as busy as never before. The high bay is growing further and further, and the first level already has all the wall panels as well. According to my prediction, we'll at least see two more levels on top of that to make a Superheavy Starship booster actually fit into it. These things will be massive. Big Blue, or Bluezilla, the large crane, is already up again doing its work after it got taken down in preparation for Hurricane Hannah. Progress will continue now. Next up, we have Nosy Ellie, as my editor and I like to call it now. This is where SpaceX is testing different nose designs. So, most of the Starship noses you can see here will most likely be pathfinders of some sort. The stacked one might be intended for Starship serial number 8 though, and we should see that fly in the next month or so. Interesting to note is that there are also 3 more nose tips here by now, and 1 more upper header tank. This would get the number up to 7 noses in the work. What's the big plan here, Elon? Will all of them fly at some point? And if we look into the same nose cone tent from the other side, there's another header tank visible. So the nose manufacturing department in Boca Chica either is on steroids or SpaceX and Musk really need a lot of nose cones for the future. Switching to the launch site, everything is focused on serial number 5 right now. The test stand surroundings are clean and cleared of any parts that might cause trouble on a Starship hop. There are a few things left around the landing pad, but I fully expect SpaceX to completely clear the area for the hop. The tank farm is fully fueled, and probably the only reason why SpaceX didn't go for a hop on Sunday was due to 2 very important passengers who booked a flight back to Earth on a Crew Dragon capsule. SpaceX will want to make sure that the media can actually concentrate on the Starship hop without having to cover another very important event at the same time. That's a nice problem to have for SpaceX though, having to shift the flight test of an interplanetary Starship in favor of a Crew Dragon's first crewed return down to Earth, right? SpaceX is showing the world how it's done, and there's no doubt they have a solid plan right now. There's one more point of interest at the launch site though that I want to direct your attention to. The Super Heavy launch pad. And it is making progress fast. This is the greater picture of the site. More and more parts have arrived to the right, where they are stored in groups for later assembly on the pad. In fact, there are parts everywhere now. Even down the ramp towards Highway 4, the sides are covered with more and more parts for later construction steps. Looking at the pad itself up close, we can see the concrete pouring has commenced. The foundation ring, the 6 large pillars under it going deep into the Boca Chica soil, and the 24 smaller concrete pillars in the middle are done now. Next, we should see SpaceX work on covering the middle and the outside. After Hurricane Hannah has passed over the site, sending immense amounts of rain down, we can see quite the erosion around the pad, and holes are filled with water. SpaceX will probably want to work on that as soon as possible to make the construction site more accessible for future tasks. There already seem to be concrete blocks going outwards between the 6 large pillars. Those could in theory also be used as access points to the pad itself. And more rebar is already on site, so work will most likely continue very soon. And there also is a blue sign on the ground next to the pad. It says SpaceX launch pad. Captain Obvious was here. I guess it's always good to have another sign. And we can also see that the whole fence surrounding the site is down right now and partly covered by mudslides that came down from the slopes while Hannah did her business. SpaceX might want to use the opportunity to put something more permanent in place. Liked the update so far? Then click the like button, subscribe to the channel, and maybe even consider becoming a patron to give some vital support. Link is in the description. The team is working relentlessly to provide you with updates twice a week, thanks to SpaceX's mind-boggling speed, and with your support it will be much easier in the future. Thank you. This is SpaceX. The rest of the industry is still frantically trying to come up with a solution to Falcon 9 taking over the launch market, and they're already making their next big innovation fly. Incredible times to be a rocket enthusiast for sure. Crew Dragon Splashdown Summary. And onwards to the next SpaceX headline. Sometimes I'm being asked in the comments if I was a SpaceX fanboy because I'm talking about them so much. Frankly though, SpaceX is the reason why I'm releasing two episodes per week. There just is no other launch provider out there that would produce enough news. If there were trophies handed out to SpaceX for every first they've accomplished in their extremely short company history, they'd have a very shiny trophy room in Hawthorne already, and they'd be polishing a new one since Sunday. What started as Launch America on May 30th with an absolutely epic launch of a Falcon 9 rocket with a NASA worm on the side and a Crew Dragon called Endeavour on top has now come to a conclusion. After undocking from the ISS on August 1st and a perfect execution of the departure burn, several phasing burns to align the descent with the landing site, a claw trunk separation and a deorbit burn executed by the four Draco thrusters on top of the capsule, the parachute sequence guided the capsule on its descent through the atmosphere. On re-entry, Endeavour endured temperatures of up to 2000 degrees Celsius or 3500 degrees Fahrenheit. After this initial re-entry phase, the drogue chutes deployed just on time at around 5,300 meters or 18,000 feet, slowing the capsule down from 560 kilometers per hour down to 190 kilometers per hour. At this point, the four main chutes opened up and slowed the capsule further down to around 25 kilometers per hour. That's the speed at which most people ride their bikes. Then came the perfect splashdown. My countdown clock on the stream was almost perfectly down to the second, and Team Space celebrated all around the globe. Mission accomplished. Coming down from the ISS is a difficult task, and SpaceX did an awesome job. The only thing that was not perfect according to the plan was some residual dinitrogen tetroxide, or NTO, left between the capsule's outer hull and the pressurized cabin. It's the fuel used in the onboard thrusters and an extremely toxic, carcinogenic and acidic substance that needed to be purged before the hatch could be opened. The concentration was extremely low though, and so after properly purging the system, the hatch could be opened and Bob Behnken and Doug Hurley got their first breath of fresh air after being in space for 2 months. Soon after, a helicopter took the two astronauts back to the shore, and a short flight on a plane then took them to Ellington Field Joint Reserve Base, which is a stone throw away from the Houston Space Center. Nothing compared to the long trips astronauts had to endure after landing in Kazakhstan as done with the Russian Soyuz capsules. And of course, both gave a speech as soon as they arrived. Let's listen in to what they had to say.
We're not going to stand right now. For those of you who have done this before, you know it's not pleasant standing for a few hours after you get back. 5 hours ago, we were in a spaceship bobbing around, making prank satellite phone calls to whoever we could get a hold of, which was kind of fun, by the way.
There's something special about having that capability to launch and bring your own astronauts home. We went through a lot of years without that capability. It took years to get here. We brought the capability back to America. And we came home safely to our families. And I think for the SpaceX team, we couldn't have asked for a more wonderful team to work with.
Elon Musk, of course, was there too to welcome the two back on Earth, and he had a few words to say as well that we should listen to, as what he said was critical in my opinion.
What this heralds really is fundamentally a new era in space exploration. We're gonna go to the moon, send people to Mars, and make life multiplanetary. And I think this day heralds a new age of space exploration. You know, I think this is something that the whole world can really look at this as an achievement of humanity. And I think this is one of those things that is universally good. No matter where you are on planet Earth, this is a good thing. And I hope it brightens your day.
Endeavour will be reused for the flight of Crew 2, which will carry Bob Behnken's wife, Megan MacArthur, up to the ISS. The mission will also reuse the booster B-1061 that will fly the Crew 1 mission this fall. It will be an almost fully reused flight up to the ISS. Shown in the picture is Crew 1, together with NASA Administrator Bridenstine and Elon Musk. They will take off from Kennedy Space Center hopefully towards the end of September, and it will mark the first regular mission for SpaceX to the ISS. No matter where you are on planet Earth, this is a good thing. I couldn't have said it better. It was clearly visible that Musk was extremely excited and emotional about the achievement, and he emphasized again that the whole world is in the same boat here. If we want to become multiplanetary, we'll have to work together. Working together in large groups is not an easy task, though, and security needs always have to be a part of the planning to keep those out who don't want to stick to the rules. This especially is true for the internet, as there is a whole industry out there trying to make money with your data. Whether it's data and identity theft, traceability, intrusive advertising, or geo-blocking, you've likely made contact with some or all of them before when moving around in the digital world. And most of the time, you're not even aware of the danger. Surfshark VPN encrypts your data and turns you into a harder target for attackers to get you. And if you're a tough target, they'll go somewhere else. Or do you want a bigger library on your favorite streaming services like Netflix or Disney Plus? Surfshark can help you there too by removing the so-called geo-block from your account. All streaming services have different catalogs in different countries. What if you could watch them all? Just activate your VPN, change your virtual location, refresh the page, and you're safe for at least another 6 months of being locked in. I use Surfshark every day. It automatically starts up whenever I start my PC, and whenever I need it, I activate it with just one click. Use my code to get 85% off plus 3 extra months for free and at the same time support What About It. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there is no risk. Surf with your own rules. Links in the description. Today I want to thank DJ Dynamike, Ron Gum, Neil Jamin, Jonathan Curtis, Jeffrey Chollock, Charles F. Scott, Eric Atkins, William Pulley, Apo Simeon, and so many others. You rock! The support I and my team are getting is absolutely overwhelming, and I cannot possibly thank you enough for giving me this opportunity to do my show for you. If you want to support the show as well, head on over to my Patreon page or hit the join button under the video to get access to our Discord, where you can talk with me almost every day and where you can get huge amounts of behind-the-scenes info from me and the team. The last words, as always, are for my team. Always there, always helping. A perfect example are my live streams, where the team does an absolutely stunning job of moderating, posting questions to me, reminding me of super chats, or just giving me that extra bit of information to make the stream as enjoyable for you as possible. Thank you so much for being a part of all of this. You rock! While Hannah did her business, SpaceX might want to use the opportunity. Soon after, a helicopter. As done with the Russian. And of course.